Hello, today I will disassemble the Nissan Note e-Power inverter. e-Power is a hybrid system developed by Nissan. The type of the system is a series hybrid system. Today I will explain the characteristics of a series hybrid system and have a look at the internal circuits of the inverter that enable such characteristics. First, I will explain the series hybrid system. I drew a diagram of the series hybrid system adopted in e-Power. e-Power consists of an engine, a motor that operate as a generator, two inverters, a battery, and a motor for driving. The main feature of this system is that the engine is dedicated solely to power generation. The engine is not for turning the wheels, but for driving the generator motor. A series system is essentially an electric vehicle with an onboard generator. That's the basic idea. This part is the generator, and this part is the electric vehicle. Let me explain the energy flow in several operation modes using this diagram. There are several modes, such as a mode where the electric vehicle operates and a mode where the generator operates. For example, there's a mode where the battery directly powers the motor. This is the typical driving state of an EV, what you'd consider normal operation. There's another mode that kicks in when you apply the brakes while the vehicle is moving. This is regenerative braking. In this mode, the car's kinetic and potential energy is recovered and sent back to the battery. In other words, the battery gets charged. Next, let's look at the mode where the engine is running. In this mode, the generator motor connected to the engine can operate to charge the battery. It's also possible for the generator to charge the battery while simultaneously supplying power to the motor that drives the wheels. When the motor is in regenerative mode, two things can happen at the same time. The wheels send energy back to the battery, and the engine can also charge the battery. In a series hybrid system, the engine is used solely to generate electricity, and it has an advantage. The engine can run at the RPM and load that deliver the best thermal efficiency. The engine consumes more fuel depending on the RPM and load conditions. With e-Power, the electricity produced by the engine is sent either to the battery or directly to the motor. This lets the system keep the engine operating within its optimal performance range. In other words, it achieves high thermal efficiency. That's how this system is able to deliver high fuel efficiency. On the other hand, this system has a drawback. The drawback is that fuel efficiency can actually be lower than other hybrid systems when driving at high speeds. For example, let's consider driving in the city. The maximum speed is usually around 60 km per hour, and there's a lot of stop-and-go traffic. Therefore, it can run solely on battery power. The engine can operate within its optimal performance range. However, at high speeds, air resistance becomes much more significant, and the vehicle can no longer rely on battery power alone, which means the engine needs to generate electricity. Because the vehicle cannot rely on battery power alone, the engine needs to generate electricity, which is then sent to the motor to keep the car moving. At this point, the energy flows like this. The engine powers the generator motor, and the electricity it produces is sent through the inverter. Here, the electricity is first converted to direct current and then sent to another inverter that drives the motor. Finally, it's sent to the motor. Let's take a look at where power losses occur. First, the generating motor itself experiences some loss. The inverter connected to it also causes some loss, and then the electricity passes through another inverter for the motor, which adds more loss. Finally, there's loss at the motor when it actually drives the wheels. It seems like quite a lot of energy is being lost. Now, let's take a look at other companies' systems. For example, Toyota Hybrid System 2 used for Toyota vehicles, which adopts a series parallel system. The engine's power is delivered to the driveshaft through the power split mechanism, allowing the vehicle to move. In Honda's EHEV parallel hybrid system, the engine can be directly connected to the driveshaft through a clutch. And lastly, in Nissan's series hybrid system, the engine has no way to connect directly to the driveshaft, which leads to greater energy losses in these areas. These system losses directly show up in the vehicle's fuel efficiency. This compares fuel efficiency based on manufacturer's figures. Nissan's e-Power delivers 28.4 km per liter in WLTC mode and 27.1 km per liter on the highway. These figures are slightly lower than the other compact cars equipped with different hybrid systems. So far, I've explained how the series hybrid system works. Now, let's go ahead and take apart the e-Power inverter itself. This is the inverter I'll be taking apart. It was removed from a Nissan Note built in April 2023, so it's relatively new. Let's take a look from the top. These are the terminals where the drive's lithium-ion battery connects. And over here on the right side of the screen, you can see the bus bar that connects to the motor or generator. When I bought this inverter, it had already been removed from the car, so I'm not entirely sure whether it was originally connected to a motor or a generator. Now I'll shift the angle a bit. These are the coolant inlet and outlet ports. I'm not exactly sure which one is the inlet and which one is the outlet. I think you could figure that out by looking at the unit while it's actually running, or by checking the service manual. Now, let's turn it over and check the backside as well. From the backside, you can see another bus bar here. This one also connects to either the motor or the generator. Let's remove the cover at the bottom. You can see the black resin part. This is a film capacitor made by Panasonic. There were several cables connected that were in the way, so I removed them all. Now I can lift and take the film capacitor out and tear it down. Before we look at the individual components, let me give you an overview of the structure. The part I just took out of here is a combination of a film capacitor and busbars. There are two copper busbars inside. They are both connected to the film capacitor right here. The role of this film capacitor is primarily to provide instantaneous current supply to the motor and generator. These parts of the busbar connect to the lithium-ion battery, so there is always voltage on the busbar. This busbar is connected to other internal components to provide voltage. I took out the busbar for the capacitor and put it back in. It connects to the other components at two points. One right here, and the other on the right side of the screen. When you lift it up, it looks like this. So what exactly are the other components? Power semiconductors. There are two stacked printed circuit boards, and beneath them are the power semiconductors. The main role of the circuit on this printed circuit board is to control the power semiconductors to regulate the current going to the electric motors and generators. This allows it to control the vehicle's acceleration and deceleration, electric power generation, battery charging and discharging, and also engine braking. There are two sets of printed circuit boards and power semiconductors. They look very similar, so they might be using exactly the same components. I'll check that later. There are two busbars that carry the voltage after it goes through the power semiconductors. They are used to connect the power semiconductors to the external generator and motor. A flexible printed circuit board is attached to the resin component that's integrated with the busbar. It's most likely there to carry the signal from the current sensor. I will also disassemble this one later. Now that we've got a general idea of how it works, I went ahead and drew the overall circuit diagram. The section highlighted in red represents the part inside the inverter unit we looked at earlier. The battery sits outside the inverter and connects to it through terminals. This section houses the control circuit and the power semiconductor modules. There are two of these modules, and each one is connected to the generator motor and the drive motor. All the current flow you see in this diagram is handled through busbars, and that's the basic structure of this inverter. As you can see from the actual inverter and its circuit, the overall construction is surprisingly simple. Now let me walk you through how the current flows using this inverter. Let's assume the circuit on the left is connected to the drive motor that turns the wheels, and the other circuit is connected to the generator motor that's linked to the engine. First, let's consider the case where the engine is not running. When power flows from the battery in the upper left through the connection terminal and into the motor, the vehicle is driving. In reality, the DC voltage from the battery enters the inverter, where it's converted into AC voltage to drive the motor. That AC power then travels to the motor through the busbar. When regenerative braking kicks in, power flows from the generator back to the battery. In other words, it's charging the battery. Next, let's consider the case where the engine is running and the generator is operating. In this case, the voltage flows to the generator, passes through the power semiconductor, and some form of power exchange happens on the generator side of the busbar. First, let's look at the mode where the generator charges the battery. In this mode, power flows to the battery. Basically, it's just the generator charging the battery. This happens when you're coasting or when the vehicle is stopped. Next, let's look at what happens when decelerating while driving. First, power from the generator flows to the battery. Then, regenerative power from the motor also goes to the battery. In other words, the battery is being charged by both the generator and the motor's regenerative power. In addition, there's a mode where the battery is charged by the generator while the motor is running to drive the vehicle. There's also a mode where the generator and the battery operate together, supplying power to the motor at the same time. This is what happens when you really step on the accelerator. There's also a mode where the power generated by the engine is used to drive the vehicle. This happens when the battery level is low or when you're driving at high speeds. By the way, the Note ePower doesn't have a starter motor. That's because the generator acts as a motor when starting the engine. Next, let's look at a special case. Imagine you're using regenerative braking on a long downhill slope. In that situation, the battery will eventually become fully charged. Once it's full, regenerative braking won't work anymore. You might think that would make the car accelerate because of the potential energy, but actually it's designed not to. What actually happens is that power from the motor is transferred to the generator. In other words, the motor acts as a generator, and the generator acts as a motor. This generator that is acting as a motor then forcibly spins the engine connected to it. It's called engine braking. At this time, the engine isn't injecting fuel, so fuel consumption is zero. If the engine braking from the generator and engine isn't enough, the foot brake handles the rest by turning the energy into heat. From here, we'll look at individual components. First, this capacitor. It's a Panasonic film capacitor. The voltage rating is 450 volts, 1010 microfarad. Panasonic ones are commonly used. Let me remove this busbar. It's actually made of two busbars laminated together. You can separate them like this. This structure is designed to minimize the inductance of the busbar. Paper is used for the insulation between the busbars. I say paper, but it's not flimsy. It's actually quite tough and hard to tear. I haven't checked the cross-sectional structure, but my guess is that this insulating paper is basically plastic sandwiched between two layers of paper. The insulation comes from the plastic in the middle. When I tore down the Hyundai IONIQ 5 from Korea before, I found insulating paper inside. This one looks like a very similar insulation method. However, the voltage class of the Note inverter is 400 volts, while that of Ioniq 5 is 800 volts. This inverter uses insulating paper for busbar insulation, but some other inverters use resin. This is a film capacitor taken out of the power control unit from the 5th generation Toyota Prius, the ZVW60. The busbars are insulated with resin. There are openings in one busbar and another busbar passes right through those holes. With a three-dimensional structure like this, insulating paper would be hard to use, which is likely why resin was chosen. On the other hand, in the case of the Nissan Note, the layout is flat, so they use insulating paper instead. They are using the right materials in the right places. By the way, do you notice anything different between the upper busbar and the lower busbar? The upper one is just a flat copper plate, but the lower one has sections that stick out a bit. These protrusions are designed to firmly hold the busbars in place when they're screwed together. They probably do this because the vibrations in cars can be quite severe. Let's take a closer look at the circuit. I'll remove this busbar for now. Let's look at the part where the printed circuit board is mounted. When you take it off, it looks like this. So it looks like there's a power semiconductor module at the very bottom, and on top of that, two printed circuit boards are stacked together. As I said earlier, the circuits on this printed circuit board are mainly for controlling power semiconductors. There's a Toshiba microcontroller on the top board. From the layout, this looks like the control board. On the backside, there are various components mounted, including a resolver IC from Tamagawa Seiki. This is the bottom board. It looks like a gate driver board. Let's check out the backside. Gate driver ICs are mounted here. They're labeled BM660, and these are gate driver ICs made by Rohm. On the top board, an ARM core microcontroller made by Toshiba is mounted. When it comes to microcontrollers for these kinds of applications, you might think of Infineon or Renesas, but Toshiba also makes microcontrollers for automotive use. The power semiconductor is a Mitsubishi Electric IGBT CT700CJ1A060. It has an aluminum fin on the back that allows for direct water cooling. It's a 6-in-1 IGBT power module designed for automotive use. The rating is 650 volts and 700 amps, making it quite a high-spec component. In this class of vehicle, they're not using silicon carbide MOSFETs. Instead, they go with silicon IGBTs to keep costs down. As I mentioned earlier, there are two components that look identical. I compared them to see what the differences are. Both boards are the same, and both power semiconductor modules are identical as well. I think the idea here is to standardize parts as much as possible to keep costs down, especially since the Note sells in large numbers. On top of that, it looks like these parts can also be used in other Nissan e-POWER models. Next, let's take a look at the busbars connected to the three-phase side of the IGBT modules. Here they are. These busbars have current sensors attached to them. You can easily remove them like this. The same sensors are used on both busbars. If you swap them like this, they'll click right into place. When I opened up this current sensor, I found three iron cores inside. There's a circuit board which can be removed just as easily. It looks like the current sensor uses hole elements. Each iron core has an opening in the center, and the hole elements are inserted into these openings. The core is made of some kind of metal. Since the motor frequency is only a few hundred hertz, metal works fine as long as the current can be sensed. Looking at the current sensor on the other busbar, it's identical in design and uses the same components as the other one. Nissan seems to be standardizing parts wherever they can. And finally, I'll remove the IGBT power modules so we can take a closer look at the coolant channels. It's designed so that the water flows at the same level once it enters. As I mentioned at the beginning of the video, the coolant inlet is located at the top of the casing, and the outlet is there as well. This part comes off. There's a protruding section here on the case. It's a temperature sensor. I'm not sure which one is the coolant inlet or outlet, but my guess is that the water channels are designed to cool the motor side IGBT first, before moving on to the other module. That's because I think the motor side IGBT operates for a longer period of time, so it makes sense to cool that side first. Let's assume the coolant enters from this side. First, it flows into this section, then travels along the backside of the cover. The coolant flows over the IGBT fins, cooling them down. Then it exits from here and flows in this direction, returning to the backside. The coolant then comes into contact with the fins of the other IGBT, cooling it down, and finally exits from here. Some inverters use different cooling methods. For example, grooves are machined into the aluminum case, allowing coolant to flow through them and cool the components on the opposite side of the case. In the Nissan Note, the inverter design is fairly simple, with a relatively small number of components, so it only needs to cool the IGBT module. Today we took a look inside the inverter used in the Nissan Note e-POWER. Since e-POWER is a series hybrid system, I anticipated a relatively simple design, and upon taking it apart, I found that the actual structure was exactly what I had expected. I think its simplicity really stands out when you compare it to the Prius inverter. The Prius inverter includes various components such as a boost circuit, which inevitably makes its structure more complex. I've done teardown videos on other inverters too, including the Prius. Check the links in the description. Thanks for watching.